good morning. I know this is a hard day, and we are here to grieve the loss of Betty Adams Davis, and this virus situation makes the grieving even more difficult with the social distancing. And so I want to welcome those who are joining this service via live stream, and I want to thank you for your presence and viewing in that way. And I know that's a source of encouragement to the family that's seated here. And it's too bad that you can't be in here, but we will all gather at the cemetery in just a little while. And so to the family that is here, I've been praying for you, and I'm trusting that you will find some comfort in the service today, and that the grieving process and the days ahead will be filled with the hope of the knowledge of the resurrection of Jesus and the presence and power of his Holy Spirit that is our comforter. I enjoyed the time I was able to spend with many of you on Tuesday as you shared your hearts and some stories, and we had some laughter, and there were some tears shed, and so I know that you've been experiencing a mix of emotions, which is a part of this journey. And so I just want to encourage you to continue to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. He loves you. He is your good shepherd, and he wants to lead you through this season of grief. On April 9th, 1945, there was a Lutheran pastor and theologian named Dietrich Bonhoeffer who was sent to the gallows in Flossenbürg concentration camp in Germany for resisting the Nazi regime. The last words of this brilliant and courageous 39-year-old pastor were, "This is the end, for me, the beginning of life." And so today seems like an end, and in many ways it is, but for Betty, we celebrate the beginning of her life in the presence of Christ. How can a person have such faith and confidence when facing death like Bonhoeffer? By knowing the one who conquered death, Jesus Christ, who is able to bring comfort to us as we grieve the loss of Betty Davis, the Holy Spirit, our comforter. The Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Rome in Romans 8, verse 11, and he said, "The Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you." And that's a powerful truth, that the same Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead dwells within us through faith. The same theologian who died at the gallows wrote a book about the Psalms, and it's called The Prayer Book of the Bible. And I want to encourage all of us in this room today to continue to see God's faithfulness that he displays through his word. And specifically in the book of Psalms, all of the different emotions that we experience as human beings are captured there. And Bonhoeffer tells us that this is pure grace, that God tells us how we can speak with God and have fellowship with him. You may have had some times in the last few days where you don't even know how to talk to God. You've maybe wondered, where is God in the midst of this pain and this sorrow? And it's hard to lose a loved one. The pain is real. The loss is significant, and I know that you are feeling it. God tells us how we can speak to him through the Psalms. Jesus used the Psalms as his prayer book. While he was dying on the cross, he prayed Psalm 22. But briefly, before we open with a word of prayer, I want us to look at Psalm 63, just a few verses of it. It's written by David, who was a shepherd king, and he wrote it when he was in a desert. And when we're grieving the loss of a family member, a loved one, we can liken it to walking through a desert. And through this Psalm of David, God tells us how to speak to him and how to have a relationship with him when we are in a desert. David says this, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole body longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water." I'm sure you've probably felt that way the last few days. But then David goes on to say, "I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory." David remembers the greatness of God. "Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you." And then to end, he says this, "On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night." Sometimes with grieving, night is the hardest most difficult. And I'm sure all of you have shed tears in the darkness of the night as you have been on your beds. But David says, because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. And then he says, I cling to you, your right hand upholds me. I want to encourage you to cling to God. He will uphold you. C.S. Lewis said that we should bring to God what is in us, not what ought to be in us. Another author has picked up on this quote and written, the oughts, how we feel like we ought to feel in times like this, will keep us from telling the truth. They will also keep us from feeling the truth, especially the truth about our pain. There's a lot of pain. I want you to be honest and real today with your pain as you lift that up to the Lord. When Jesus realized the nearness of his own death, he went to a quiet place and prayed. We are told that he agonized with loud crying and tears. We are also told that he fell to the ground where he prayed fervently and sweated profusely. This was a real portrait, a portrait of how we pray when the earth beneath our feet begins to quake. We pray however we can, with whatever words we can. We pray with our sweat and with our tears, and with whatever friends we have who will sit with us in the darkness. There are people in the parking lot. There are people watching this via live stream who are sitting with you in your dark hour, who are praying for you and encouraging you in this time. And so I want us to go to the Lord today with whatever raw feelings we have in our heart, the sorrow, the pain, the sadness, the questions. Death can often provoke a lot of questions in us. Why? Why now? Why in this way? But God knows, and we're going to trust him together. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, humbly seeking your peaceful presence that only you can give when we are walking through the storms of this life. And particularly today, Lord, this family seated in front of me is experiencing tremendous loss and grief and heartache and sadness. And I pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit, you would encourage them and that you would uplift them. I pray that Jesus, your model of crying out to your Heavenly Father, would be a model to them during this dark hour. That they would know that you are their strength. You are their hope. You are their ever-present help in time of trouble. We thank you for the life of Betty Davis and for the way that she influenced each one of us. And we pray that this service would honor and respect her life. And Lord Jesus, that we would also be pointed to you, because you are the resurrection and the life. So may everything that happens in this service be honoring and pleasing to you. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to have a song played right now, and it's called Go Rest High on That Mountain.
Go to gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high.
Davis, 79, of Auburndale, Florida, passed away unexpectedly at home on Sunday, April 26, 2020. And as I talked to some of the family members, the unexpected is challenging, isn't it? Death is always a challenge, to be sure, but nobody was expecting this. Ecclesiastes 3 tells us that there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die. A little bit later in that chapter, it says, He, God, has made everything beautiful in His time. And so it's unexpected from our perspective, from our time frame, and somehow in God's perfect plan and in His ways, it's how He wanted it. And so we as children of God are called to walk by faith and not by sight. And so I want to encourage you that even though it was unexpected from our standpoint, God knows what He is doing. Betty was born in Tallahassee, Florida in 1940 to Henry Daye and Ruby Castleberry Daye. In 1945, they moved from Tallahassee to Winter Haven, Florida, where she attended area schools, finishing up at Winter Haven High School. On October 19th, 1956, Betty married Glenn Adams at the Methodist Church in Winter Haven, and together they had four children. They also attended the First Alliance Church of Winter Haven, where they were charter members. They were married for 36 years until Glenn passed away on July 17, 1992. In November 1997, Betty married Bill Davis and then retired from beautiful Cypress Gardens where she had worked for 25 years. Others in need. She was a member of the Auburndale Lions Club, loved gardening and seasonal trips to Bryson City, North Carolina, with her longtime friend, Richard Oxford. She was preceded in death by her parents, Henry and Ruby Daye, husband Glenn Adams, son David Glenn Adams, and her second husband, Bill Davis. Betty is survived by her daughters, Karen, who was married to Jim McCaller, Gail Pyle, and Renee, who was married to Jimmy Sellers, five grandchildren, Whitney, who was married to Brandon, Lee, Rod Pyle, Jacob, who was married to Sierra Sellers, Austin McCaller, and Adam Pyle. Two great-grandchildren, Kylie Southard and Anthony Lee, also her longtime companion, Richard Oxford. She loved all of you dearly, didn't she? And you loved her dearly. And so when I was gathered with you earlier this week, I could just feel the warmth in the room that was being expressed with the love in this family. And so I am honored to be a part of this celebration of life for her, in remembering her life and all the ways that she has impacted us. There's some humor that needs to be stated. I have been told that Betty was not very proficient with technology, but she did discover Facebook Marketplace and seemed to enjoy making purchases and then sending her daughters and Richard out on treasure hunts to get the goods. So I think you discovered that a little bit of knowledge with technology can be a dangerous thing, but potentially fun as well. Karen, Gail, and Renee also shared with me some stories of a more recent Black Friday tradition with their mother that included having a meal at Lavender and Lace and then a shopping outing at the Barn Antique Store in Lake Alfred. The most concerning aspect of this tradition for me, after hearing the story, was the fact that they almost got kicked out of the barn for being so rowdy, trying on hats and sunglasses, and just being crazy. But I love that story. So it really wasn't that. Funneling me stories of laughter and fun, and I think that's wonderful and that's great. Richard, I have a few stories about you as well. I'm not going to share all of them, but my understanding is that you had your own Christmas shopping tradition with Betty on the first Tuesday in December at Bell's, because that was Senior Day, and you got 15% off plus free gift wrapping. I applaud you for being a bargain shopper, and especially given those discounts go a long way when you have as many grandkids and great-grandkids as you were buying gifts for. But I'm sure that's a fond memory that you have and that you will cherish. And part of the funny aspect of the story for me was hearing that sometimes you forgot to put names on those gifts and they all got mixed up. And with that big of a pile of gifts, that would be a hassle to figure that out. But lots of good memories, lots of good laughter, lots of just fun being together as a family and developing relationships, and that's what family is all about. Every opportunity that we have to connect with family members is a gift from God, and God is a graceful God. And another song that's been selected for this service is Amazing Grace, and so we're going to take this opportunity now to just listen to the words of this very familiar hymn, but I want you to think about how graceful God has been to you in allowing you to be blessed with Betty.
Amazing grace.
how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, shining as the sun.
Give me some words and phrases to describe Betty. And here are some of the responses. Beautiful person, incredibly caring, giving, unconditional love, kind, a giving heart, constantly looked out for others, selfless, she cared about others more than herself, servant of God, generous. In my interactions with Betty, she always just exuded this kindness, this love, this sensitivity. And so I think you've captured well what a beautiful person she was. And yet the last word that I read that you gave me, generous, is the word and the quality of Betty that I really want to focus on just for just a few minutes today. Because it's such a powerful trait and yet such a rare one in our culture today. It's hard to find people who have a truly generous heart. Betty was a giver, right? She was quick to help others who were in need. And she contributed to all kinds of needs. On Tuesday, you were sharing with me all the different organizations and people that she contributed to, and it was amazing. Powerful to hear that testimony. One of you shared with me that your mom felt as if she was blessed and want it to be a blessing to others. I believe Betty was a generous servant of God who realized she had received abundant blessings from God, and the only appropriate response was for her to share the blessings with others. To whom much is given, much is required. There's a book in the New Testament, it's called 2 Corinthians, and there's a couple verses that I want to just highlight. The letter was written by the Apostle Paul, and he was encouraging a church in Corinth to give money to some needs in the church in Jerusalem. And Paul was not commanding the church to give, but he said to the church, I want to test the sincerity of your love. And I think Betty's generous and caring and giving heart revealed in a very practical way the sincerity of her love. She truly loved. It wasn't a show. It wasn't superficial. It wasn't fake. It was the real deal. Paul goes on to say, after he says, I want to test the sincerity of your love, that for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Now that might be kind of confusing and hard to follow. I want to try and unpack it for a minute. Jesus Christ left the glory of heaven and took on the poverty of human flesh. In his earthly human life, Christ suffered. He grieved, just like you're grieving today. He got tired. He got hungry. He got thirsty. He wept at the tomb of his friend Lazarus, who had died. Jesus experienced the pain of the crucifixion on the cross for our sins. That was his intentional way of becoming poor, so that through his death and resurrection from the dead, we would have the opportunity to become rich in him. Rich in salvation, rich in peace, rich in righteousness, rich in the hope of everlasting life. The generosity of God involved the poverty of the Son of God so that we could become rich in God. I think Betty lived out of that richness that she had experienced from God. But the generosity of God came with a huge price. John 3:16, a verse that probably most of you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved that he gave. Betty so loved that she gave. Whatever it was that was needed, she gave it, following in the footsteps of God. And when I think of Betty as the generous servant of God that she was, I think of someone who understood the economics of heaven. She had received the generous love of God through faith, and that God had changed her. She was a new creation who understood that you can't outgive God. She realized that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Paul wrote, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Paul realized that he was who he was because of the grace of God that was simply given to him. I'm sure all of you were recipients of many things that Betty gave to you over the years. Just that overflowing generosity for her, from her life into yours. And I want you to see that as a picture of God's love and God's grace that was welling up from within her and overflowing into the lives of others. It was the gift of God's grace that changed Paul. It was the gift of God's grace and love that I believe changed Betty. And the question that all of us have to answer is, have we received the gift of God's love through Jesus Christ? I think there's a challenge here for us from Betty's life, a challenge to live out a portion of her legacy. And I would encourage you to live generously, follow in her footsteps, and be a gift giver. But the only way to be a true gift giver is to be first a gift receiver, because God has so much that he wants to give us. His love, his son Jesus, his grace. The only way to shine the light of Jesus is to possess the light of Jesus. The only way to share the good news, message of God's abundant love and grace and the salvation available through Christ is to receive Christ as our Savior and King. In my years of ministry, I have come to understand this. The best gift that you can give to anyone in your family is a surrendered life to Jesus. That gift is infinitely better than providing your family with a wonderful house or a new car or a well-paying job or a growing retirement fund. The best gift that you and I can give to anyone in our family is a surrendered life to Jesus. With what Betty is experiencing right now, I can confidently say that she would say exactly what I am saying to you. About a month ago, I was in a hospice facility in Chicago at the bedside of my father as he was drawing closer to his own death. A few times he woke up from his frequent naps and asked me, "Am I in heaven yet?" And I would have to look at him and say, "No, Dad, you're not in heaven yet. You still have to put up with me." And he was so ready to meet his Savior because he so loved Jesus and was really tired of all the physical suffering that he had had to endure. He loved the Lord, and he knew where he was going. He didn't fear death. Last night, I don't know, some of you probably had a hard time sleeping. It's hard to sleep during times like this. And I had a little hard time unwinding last night, too. And so I started to think about this service, what you all are going through. I started to think about my dad and his death. And at about 4 in the morning, I came to the conclusion that my dad had given me the best gift that he could ever give me by surrendering his life to Jesus. My dad was a wonderful dad. We had a home that was nice. We always had pretty decent cars, and he had a well-paying job. But the best gift was that he had surrendered his life to Jesus, so that while I was at his bedside, knowing that he was going to be taking his last breath soon, it was a worshipful experience, incredibly painful, but also incredibly hopeful. And I believe Betty would tell all of us in this room and those that are watching via live stream that the best gift you can give to anyone in your family is a surrendered life to Jesus. Betty was a great gift giver, but the greatest gift giver is God himself, who has given us his son. In just a moment, we're going to listen to one of Betty's favorite songs, or one of her favorite songs, and it is called "It Is Well With My Soul." And the person who wrote this hymn had just gone through a terrible loss of experiencing the loss of 4 of his daughters in a shipwreck. And as he was going back out to sea and nearing the place where his daughters had perished in that wreck, these are the words that came to him. And this is the song that emerged from that tragic situation out at sea. God bringing peace, calm, and stillness in the midst of the storm. And God wants to do the same thing for you during this really hard, stormy season. He wants you to know that it is well because he is in control. He wants you to trust him. He wants you to find your peace and your strength in him. And so let's listen to this song and just worship and just trust God to give us the strength and the peace in the days ahead.
Thank you.
forward a prayer. I'm just going to give us just a little bit of time in silence. Scripture says to be still and to know that He is God, that He is the one who is in control of all things. His timing is perfect. He can be trusted. He knows what He's doing. He's a good God, faithful. Wants to give peace today. So in this moment of stillness, just ask Him for that peace. Father, we thank You for Your presence in our lives and in this place. We thank You for the comforting presence of Your Holy Spirit. And Lord, I pray a blessing over the family that is in here today and those that are not able to be in here, that they would experience Your supernatural peace that goes well beyond anything that their human minds can comprehend. May it be a deep peace in their souls. May they realize that it cannot come from any other person other than You. And Lord, in the days ahead, when waves of grief come over them and You are with them, I pray that they would continue to keep their eyes firmly fixed on You, Jesus, because You are the author and the perfecter of their faith. I pray that they would know what a generous God You are. And You've been generous in blessing our lives with Betty. All the ways she has given to us, all the ways she has demonstrated generosity. Lord, I believe that is because she had received Your generous love in her life, and she lived out of an overflow, out of an abundance, God, of what You had done. May the same be true of us. May we be seekers of You, Lord. May we hunger for Your word. And then as we are filled, may it overflow to the people around us. And I pray that there would be people who would come into the lives of this family as they continue to grieve, to be sources of encouragement and hope, be people of prayer who will come alongside of them and just continue to cheer them on. Lord, we thank You for this time of honoring Betty's life and for the opportunity to direct our eyes to Your scriptures, which are words of truth that give us hope. Bless this family. Encourage them, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen.